I glorify him today. I magnify him today, praise God. Hallelujah, because he's good, amen. I said he's good and his mercy endures. Hallelujah, his mercy endures forever. Hallelujah. I said his mercy endures forever. Hallelujah. Glory to the name of Jesus. Oh, there's a little song that's on my heart, praise God. A little song that's on my heart. I want to just magnify him right now. I just want to worship him. Praise God. A little song says, oh, come, let us adore him. Hallelujah. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy, Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. Just wave your hands to him right now if you would, praise God. Just give him a wave offering right now. Just in your wave offering, just let him know how much you think of, how much you love him. Hallelujah. Just in your wave offering, let him know how much you appreciate him. Just in your wave. Father, we love you today. Father, we magnify you today. There's nobody like you, Jesus. There's nobody like you, Lord. You alone are worthy, God. You alone are worthy, God. You alone are worthy, God. There's nobody like you, Lord Jesus. No matter how difficult the times may get in our lives, Father God, we thank you that we have a present help in the time of trouble. Thank you, Lord God, that we have a strength. We have a rock that we can lean upon. Thank you, Lord, that we have a pillar, hallelujah, Lord God, that never fails. Hallelujah. I give you the praise and the glory today, Father God. Bless this service. Bless this word. Bless your children, Lord God. Bless your children, God. Send your anointing, Lord God, to minister to their needs today, Lord Jesus. Hungry for you today, Lord. Hungry for you, Lord. Hungry for your presence, God. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Amen. Glory to God. You may be seated in the house of the Lord, all except Sister Faye. Go ahead. If you don't mind, bring that temperature down a little bit. I don't know who be cold up in here, praise God. Hallelujah. You need to bring a coat, praise God. You need to, hallelujah. Get that brother a cover. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Lordy, have mercy today, Jesus. Brother Ronnie, you know we're not going to satisfy everybody with this thermostat. It's like that at home, too. Well, you know what? I know what that's like. But you know what? For some reason, I guess the common thinking is that the female, the woman, is the one that typically ends up, the older she gets, the more she needs air conditioning. Praise God. And I'm not sure if that's a standard rule that applies for every individual, amen? Because I'll never forget back in Lake Charles, man. We built our house back in Lake Charles. I built that house with 2 4-ton air conditioners. And you know what? That still wasn't enough to keep me cool. I was a young man at the time, praise God. My wife can tell you, I would wake up at night soaking wet with sweat. I just can't get cool enough up in here. But something happened to my metabolism as I got older. It seemed like, man, all of a sudden, man, when she got the air conditioner on 69, I got the heater on in my office, man. I got the little flow heaters where I said, okay, you can have it your way over there. Praise God. I'll just stay in my office. And I just put my little flow heater on and I just put my hand next to the heater. We're not going to be able to please everybody. Amen. But I told my wife, I said, but up here preaching, and I know that on this end of the room is probably hotter than it is down there. But the last thing I think y'all want is for pastor to pass out for heat exhaustion. Amen. So if y'all could just put on I don't have a jacket, but they got, hallelujah, glory to God. We'd like to welcome all you guys into the house of the Lord today, praise God. I hope you feel welcome. I hope you feel welcome. I honestly do. We want to welcome those. We are live streaming on Facebook. We want to welcome those who may be watching us, praise God, live on Facebook. Amen. You're welcome to sit in with us for a few minutes, praise God. I really believe that God has a word for his people. Amen. I do. I really believe that God has a word for his people. Amen. And it's a good thing. Amen. It's a good thing, praise God. And I don't know how any of you feel. And I know that I'm just going to tell off on myself a little bit. Every now and then, if I find myself in a situation, maybe my mood is wrong, I don't want to talk to nobody. Do I, Sister Faye? Hallelujah. I must have got that from my sister or something. Amen. When I find myself maybe, and sometimes, praise God, and it's not necessarily that I'm in a bad mood. Sometimes my mind could be in the Word. My mind could be that I'm hearing something from God. My mind could be that I'm hearing, and I'm really waiting to hear. And I don't really want to be distracted with outside conversations, praise God. And I know that's rude, but if that's the case, and I really want to apologize, praise God, because that's never my intention to seem rude or to be like that, praise God. But there are some times, praise God, that, and I hope that you will know this and experience it in your own lives, that there are times where God wants to speak to you and he don't want nobody else intruding. Amen. Amen. So it's a good thing, praise God, that God has given us amen, still speaks to us by his Spirit. Amen. We're going to ask you, if you would, we're going to open up from the book of Jeremiah chapter 5. And we're going to begin reading at verse number 1. And I'm going to give this microphone to Sister Faye, if she'll help me. Not with this scripture, but for some of the others that I'll be ministering from as we get into this lesson today. Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse number 1. Praise God. Hallelujah. Jesus. I praise you, Father. I praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Some of these messages that you guys, some of these teachings and lessons that you're hearing now and that I anticipate you're going to continue to hear, praise God, are not going to be in your top 10 most popular messages to preach. How many of you know that it's not the popularity of the message that brings salvation? It's a repentant heart, amen? It's a repentant heart. It's not how popular, it's not how well I preach or how, that's not where salvation comes from. And I want God to use me, praise God, and I'm not, like I always say, I'm not really an eloquent speaker. Love the word of God. Just if God would just use me for a few minutes, praise God, to deliver, amen, an anointing that will destroy the yokes in your lives through this word. Amen. Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse number 1 says this. He says, run ye to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem and see and know and seek in the broad places thereof. If you can find a man, if there be any that executed judgment,
that seeketh the truth, and I will pardon it. Go out into the broad places. Go out into the highways and the hedges. Begin to examine. Look at the people that you see and talk to in the supermarkets. Look at the people that you talk to and interact with when you go down to get your car inspected. Look at the people that you interact with, praise God, when you go into the washateria to wash your clothes. Just, he said, and just see and know if you can find a man who's going to be executing judgment and seeking the truth. He said, and if you can find them, he said, I will pardon it. Our lesson today is going to be entitled, Seek the Truth, and you're going to find true freedom. Seek the truth, and you'll find true freedom. As I began to hear from the Lord about this lesson, he took me to this scripture in Jeremiah, and I began to think about what was going on in the time when Jeremiah was a prophet. We're going to find in these times that these were the children of God, the children of Israel, had found themselves once again in a place where they had totally forsaken God. The priesthood had become so corrupt that God had to select Jeremiah from his mother's womb to ordain him. Hallelujah. That's a bad situation, you hear me? If you can't find any of those that were ordained priests, those who were conducting all the ceremonies among them, he said, if you find any that are executing judgment, if you find any that are seeking the truth, he says, then I'm going to forgive whatever their situation, whatever their flaws and their deficiencies are, I'm going to forgive them. I'm going to look over them to make sure to give them another opportunity, amen, to get it right. If they're just seeking after me, not saying that they're doing everything 100% right now, but at least if they're striving to do it, at least if they're seeking, if their heart is broken whenever they don't meet the criteria. If I can find anybody whose heart is broken, praise God. He said, and I'm going to look over them with a special dispensation of my grace. Hallelujah. And whatever their sin is, I'm going to pardon them. Isn't that a loving God? Hallelujah. But this, in the time when Jeremiah wrote these passages and God was dealing with him, God called Jeremiah, and you guys all know this, know the history, praise God. When God began to speak to Jeremiah, began to reveal unto Jeremiah the method by which he was going to begin to give his word to Jeremiah, Jeremiah said, no, he said, Lord, I'm just a child. How can these things be? I'm just a child. And God began to respond back to Jeremiah and told him, say not that thou art just a child. Because it's not going to be you that's going to bring the deliverance. He said, it's me. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. It's going to always be the power of God. And that's a lesson, praise God, that we as teachers and we as ministers need to learn. That it's not by our power. Nothing that takes place is by our power. Nothing that takes place is by our might, but it's by the Spirit of God. Praise God that men are brought to the place of salvation. Hallelujah. Told Jeremiah, he said, before I formed you in your mother's womb, he said, I had chosen you and I to prophesy against the nations and to prophesy against the kingdoms and to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. And we see God here in a manner of speaking. God was pleading with the children of Israel, those that he called his beloved, pleading with them to turn themselves back to him. And I know God is putting this message on my heart because I believe, praise God, that this is the word that God is speaking to his children even today. Hallelujah. It's just not to criticize or to say that we're doing everything wrong, praise God. But if you read in the book of Revelation, there were seven churches that John wrote to in the book of Revelation. Only two out of the seven had a testimony that they did everything like God wanted it to be done. With the other five, praise God, there was always a good admonition. And then God would say, but I have somewhat against thee. Hallelujah. You did this well. Hallelujah. And I'm not trying to discourage you through the chastisement. I'm trying to encourage you and let you know that I've given you power over all the power of the enemy. And that nothing that you face is going to have enough strength and power to hurt you. Hallelujah. Praise God. The word is fulfilled in our lives. As we walk by faith, that says no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. But you got to walk by faith for that word to be fulfilled. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. Sister Faye, if you read Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse number 13 for me, please. God was pleading with his children. He wanted to establish a holy nation. And he was willing, praise God, and he still is willing to do whatever it takes to remove the things that are going to offend, the things that are going to rebel against his will. Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse number 13, if you got it, go ahead.
Okay. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water.
Read it again, please, if you don't mind.
For my people have committed two evils.
Two evils.
They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters.
They have forsaken me. I am the fountain of living waters. Every other place you look for living waters, you're not going to find it there. Every other place that makes the claim, every other God that makes the claim that they can provide what I'm providing, that God is lying to you. Hallelujah. He said, they have forsaken me. I am the fountain of living waters. And what have they done?
And hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water.
Y'all know what a cistern is? A cistern is like a clay vessel. When that woman went to the well, that Samaritan woman, to gather that water from the well, all of those vessels that she poured that water into, that could be considered a cistern, okay, a water pot, okay, a vessel of those sorts. And God is saying in this particular passage that if I am the fountain of living water, but what you are not satisfied with me, so you went out and established your own gods. That's right. Hallelujah. You went out and developed, you established your own methods of worship. But the thing about your methods of worship is that whereas I am the vessel that can hold water, what you have hewn out, what you've built is a vessel that cannot hold water. Leaking, dripping. You start out with a full vessel of water, and by the time you get home, all your water's gone. Hallelujah. And you know, I know this was prior to Christ, but don't you know we do the same thing today? Hallelujah. This is a word, praise God, that I know God is speaking to this last day church. Because many of us have hewn out vessels. Praise God. And that's why many of us are not powerful. We're not strong in the Lord as we ought to be. Praise God. Hallelujah. Sister Tasha here several years ago, praise God, went down to Walmart to get an oil change in a car. Praise God. She told me that they did something to the drain plug and didn't put it in right or something, and she ended up losing all the oil they put in it. When you have a situation like that, praise God, you have a situation where a lot of damage can be done. Yes. Hallelujah. And you don't want to try to drive that vehicle when it ain't got no oil in it. So you don't ever want to try to go up against the devil and you ain't got no oil in you.
Come on, come on.
Come on, somebody.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. He said, my people have committed two evils. He said, they've forsaken me. And that they've gone out to establish their own. Oh, that's what he said. Isn't that what, that's what he said? He said, they've gone out to establish their own righteousness. Hallelujah. And by establishing their own righteousness, they have not conformed themselves to the righteousness of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 1, Sister Faye, in verse number 2 and 3. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. Hallelujah. Praise God. I just want you to hear the heart of God concerning his people in this, at this time. Praise God. Hallelujah.
You ready?
Yes, ma'am.
The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children.
I have nourished and brought up children. Come on.
And they have rebelled against me.
Jesus. You know, when our kids were growing up, praise God, my wife can tell you. Man, I'll tell you, I had rules in my house. And if you were my child living in my house, you had to abide by my rules. Amen. God is saying, I have I'm feeding you, and you're still going to rebel against me? I provided a place for you to sleep, and you're still going to rebel against me? When you got old enough and needed a car, I went out and financed a vehicle for you to drive, and you're still going to rebel against me? Can you imagine the anger possibly and the disappointment in the heart of God to a people who would do such a thing? Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Read on. Hallelujah.
Hear, O heavens, and give ear. Oh, I read that one.
That's okay.
Three. The ox knoweth his owner,
mm-hmm.
and the ass his master's crib.
Mm-hmm.
But Israel doth not know. My people doth not consider.
Hallelujah. They don't realize how blessed that they were. And I was thinking about this, praise God, a few weeks ago, as God began really to speak to me about some things in my own life, in my own ministerial pathway, praise God. And God began to speak some things to me concerning Ken Smith going forward, praise God. And as he began to speak these things to me, I had to stop and consider what he's saying. Praise God. Because I don't want to get into that right now. Praying God had to consider what God is saying. The Bible speaks in one place. He said, let him that hath an ear, let him hear. Are y'all hearing me? What the Spirit saith unto the churches, praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And this wasn't the first time that God encountered this kind of rebellion with his people. What did they do when they crossed that Red Sea? They were all rejoicing and happy, happy, happy. Praise God, it was the tambourines were singing. Praise God, they were rejoicing because Pharaoh had died and his army had perished in the Red Sea. In a few days, man, they got out there and began murmuring and complaining against God. It didn't take them long. They began murmuring and complaining against Moses. Why have you brought us out here for us to perish? And they kept doing this over and over and over again. But this situation here in Jeremiah reminds me of another time when the children of Israel rebelled against God. Praise God. Hallelujah. There was a place called, a couple of cities called Sodom and Gomorrah. Y'all ever hear those places? Abraham and Lot were traveling, and Lot decided, I want to go live over here. Got over there, and there was nothing but wickedness, 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 wickedness. Praise God. God decided, I'm going to send judgment against that city. Abraham began to plead with God. Hallelujah. Even as Moses used to plead with God to save and to have mercy on the people, Abraham pleaded, said, Lord, he said, if we can find 50 righteous in the city, will you spare the city? God said, okay, if I can find 50 righteous, I'll spare the city. Hallelujah. Couldn't find 50. If there are 40 righteous, if there are 30 righteous, and he kept on playing. What's the name of that game? Let's make a deal. He kept trying to make a deal with God. He got down to 20 and he got down to 10. And he said, if you can find 10 righteous in the whole cities, God said, I will spare them and I will not destroy them because of their wickedness. Hallelujah. And you know what happened, saints of God? There cannot be found 10 righteous to give themselves that opportunity to be saved. So God sent destruction upon them. And whenever I read these stories and I think about what God is speaking unto us now in this generation, and I know a lot of folks are not going to believe this, praise God, because most people in church especially believe that where the crowds are is where God is. Hallelujah. Yes, they do. Hallelujah. They believe that where the crowds are, where the money is, where the big cathedrals are, that's where God is. But the Bible tells me something totally different, praise God. And we do well to take heed to what the Word of God says. Amen. One thing that we understand is that God's not going to build his church on a faulty foundation. Come on. Hallelujah. When I heard the Lord speak that to me about a faulty foundation, I immediately thought about California. Do you know why there are so many earthquakes over there? Because there are so many fault lines. There are so many fault lines. Up until yesterday, and I hadn't been out there since the rain yesterday, but up until then, I'm telling you the truth. There were gaps in my backyard that were this wide. Had a couple of little trees I'm trying to grow in the back, praise God. The earth was separating all the way around them. I'm like, Lord, the earth gonna swallow my little trees up. Hallelujah. My wife can tell you, I told her, I said, I've been looking for the little creatures to come up crawling up. I've watched too many science fiction movies. Amen. Little creatures crawling up out of the ground. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. But God's not going to build his house up on a church that has fault lines in the foundation. I was noticing here a couple of weeks ago, one of my neighbors redid their covering in the back of their backyard of their house. And I noticed as they were working, they had one of these big machines with a big jackhammer bit on it to break up the old slab. Hallelujah. And they had trucks and move equipment to lift it up and put it in the trucks to haul that old concrete out, and they poured new concrete back there when they put that new addition onto that house. When I read this about God not building his house where there are fault lines, God would have to do the same thing. This is what he was telling Jeremiah. He said, I've ordained you to root out, to break up that fallow ground. I've ordained you to go in and to root it out, to throw down, to pull down everything that's not like me, everything that's offering resistance to my will. And only after you've removed all of that stuff are you going to be able to build and to plant. Are y'all with me today? Amen. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Paul said this. Paul said, the foundation of the Lord standeth sure, having this seal, that the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let every man that nameth the name of Christ do what? Depart from iniquity. Amen. If we're naming the name of Christ, praise God, we have to depart from the things that are causing us to be separated from God. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. In Psalms 119, David said this. In verse 104, David said, through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore I hate every false way. He said, I hate every false way. Did you not realize God hates every false way? And God has already told us, praise God, in these last days that, well, we hear this, perilous time is coming. The time would come when they would not endure sound doctrine. The time would come when they would turn away their ears from the truth and be turned unto fables. Turn their ears away from the truth and be turned unto fables. And as I begin to stop and think about what that looks like, praise God, and I had to go back and begin thinking in the carnal mind to understand what it's like to turn away. What is the benefit of turning away from truth and turning unto fables? And the only thing that I could come up with is that for the temporary moments and for the temporary situation, there's a feel good that's happening in my life. Come on now. For a temporary, Paul said, pray God, he said in one place, our light afflictions, which are but for a moment, they're going to work for us a far more and exceeding weight of glory. While we look not for those things that are temporary, but we look for those things that are eternal. Praise God. So that the carnal mind is always looking for whatever it can receive to make him feel good and make him happy for the moment. Are y'all hearing me today? Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. He said that they would not endure sound doctrine, that they turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. You know what lasciviousness is? Lasciviousness is extreme and excessive lust. They won't just stop with a man committing adultery with a woman. Now he's taking that way off the charts. Praise God! It just broke my heart the other day. There's a Robin Roberts on ABC News. Man, I've been watching Robin for a long time. Just broke my heart. I knew that she had a girlfriend, but somewhere in the back of my mind, I guess I thought that they were already married. But they were celebrating her wedding this past week. And it just reminded me, Lord, look how far we've fallen. Look how far we've departed away from the truth. And nobody, listen, even your major prophets and pastors and ministries are not crying aloud to let people know that these are things that God is not pleased with. Hallelujah. And I know that's none of you guys, that doesn't apply to you. But praise God, I'm talking to the one that's watching me on this video. Hallelujah. Praise God. Oh.
Come on.
Y'all getting me off track now.
Come on.
Y'all getting me off track now. Go to the, hallelujah, go to the book of 1 Corinthians. Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. I mean, 2 Corinthians, I'm sorry. I think it's 2 Corinthians. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians. Oh, Father, help me. Help us. Where's that scripture, Sister Faye? No, you're not. That's in 1 Corinthians, isn't it? That the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. That's in 1 Corinthians. Isn't that right? It's in 1 Corinthians. Hallelujah. You find it? Brother can't get no help. Brother can't get no help. That's okay.
It's in 1 Corinthians.
1 Corinthians what?
6 and 9.
Okay. Isn't that what I said? No. Not quite. I was flipping, flopping. I was tossed to and fro. Read that for me, Sister Faye. 1 Corinthians, begin in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse number 9. This is off my text, but I hear it right now. Praise God. Go ahead.
Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God?
Don't you know that those who live unrighteously are not going to inherit the kingdom of God? Hallelujah. This is not a judgment that a man can put on any other man. This is a decision and a judgment that will come from God alone. Are y'all hearing me today?
Amen.
And I know that when we make these statements, we're preaching his word and telling people what thus saith the Lord. They think that you're preaching your own ideas. They're thinking that you're preaching what you want to preach, because maybe you're not guilty about this thing. But no matter what, if I'm guilty of a certain thing, pray God, I can't go around that thing. I got to repent of that thing. Hallelujah. Because that thing, if that thing is considered unrighteous, listen, I'm going to fall in the same judgment as the other person will. Amen. God is no respecter of persons. Hallelujah. Come on, Sister Faye.
Be not deceived.
Last week I told y'all, man, it seemed like everywhere Jesus talked and the disciples began to teach, this is something you're going to see in so many passages. Let no man deceive you. Be not deceived. Paul said it in another place. Be not deceived, for God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Are y'all hearing me today?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on with it, Sister Faye.
Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate.
Mm-mm, stop right there. Need I say anything more? Y'all know what an effeminate is? Just think about it. Just the word almost describes itself. Praise God. Now, go on down to verse number 11, Sister Faye.
And such were some of you.
Such were some of you. Some of us used to be effeminate. Some of us at one time were fornicators. Some of us at one time were liars and thieves and whoremongers. Hallelujah. But when you come into God, you come to God dirty, a sinner, pray God, needing, pray God, deliverance. And once you, if you come unto him, Jesus says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'm going to give you rest. And if you take his yoke upon you and learn of him, you'll find out, pray God, that living this life of holiness is not so hard after all. He said, my yoke is easy. You know why? Because I'm not doing it on my own power. I'm not doing it by my own might. Hallelujah. If I send you to the store and say, run down and get me, praise God, one of them juicy watermelons from H-E-B. And if I give you a $10 bill, then ain't no sweat off your back. You know what I'm saying? I've given you the power to get what I sent you to get. Come on, y'all. Y'all got to hear me now. I've given you the power to get what I told you to get. So you shouldn't come back home saying, I couldn't do it. I couldn't have enough money. No, I gave you plenty enough money. Amen. If it's more than $10, they can't keep it. Praise God. And what God is saying, I've given you my spirit. And there's nothing that my spirit can't accomplish. Oh, y'all done got quiet on me. Maybe I shouldn't have gone through this Corinthians, Sister Faye. I hope I don't have none of y'all up in here still doing this kind of stuff.
Come on. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He said, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards. Forget this stuff about drink a little wine for your stomach's sake. People use that as a cloak to go out and get them a little, hey man, a little, because they don't want to deny the flesh. Honey, they still got Boone's Farm on the mind. They still, hallelujah. Who, MD 2020, they still got that in the heart, pray. The heart has not been purged. So they'll look for a reason. And they'll find the preacher who will give them the reason. Give them to think that God is not going to hold this against them. But Brother Ken is always going to stick with what this word says, okay? We got to transition ourselves away from emotion-based religion and transition ourselves into word-based religion, praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. We're not saved by our emotions. You're not saved by you're not delivered because you feel good. I know I'm delivered when I'm in a trial and the devil can't put nothing on me. Hallelujah. Y'all know what's that guy's name that did that song? Do 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 do. Can't touch this. MC Hammer. Praise God. You know you deliver when the devil come up, when the enemy come in as a flood. Come on, somebody. You know you deliver when the enemy come in as a flood and the enemy can't touch you. Hallelujah. You know you deliver when the enemy comes in and he's trying to steal your joy. And you say, devil, get thee behind me. Hallelujah. You know you got something then. Hallelujah. Praise God. Come on, somebody shout glory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Yeah, Lord. He said, neither drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Doesn't matter. You're the biggest tithe payer in the church. But if you live in this kind of lifestyle, you know where you're going to end up? You're going to bust hell wide open if you don't repent. If you don't repent. Hallelujah. And Paul said, and such were, not such are, such were, past tense. Amen. Such were some of you. He said, but now you are what?
Washed.
How many washed folks we got in the house today? Praise God. Hallelujah. I said, I'm washed, praise God. I said, I'm washed by the blood of the Lamb, praise God. And I'm not going to allow the adversary to get my clothes dirty.
Come on.
Hallelujah. I got to walk circumspect, praise God. I have to redeem the time. I have to understand that the times that we're in, they're evil times, praise God. That's what the word tells us to do. Redeem the time. For the times you're living in, they're evil times. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You're washed, you are sanctified. Not the name of the church is sanctified, but you are sanctified. You don't think like you used to think. You don't walk like you used to walk. You don't talk like you used to talk. Hallelujah. Them old friends you had, they don't want to be around you much anymore because your conversation has changed. Praise God. You know, and that's how you know when you're really free. That's how you know when you're really free. When you go into a situation and you've been tried in the fire. Oh, yes, sir, yes, ma'am. When you go into a situation, you've been tried in the fire, you've been tempted, praise God, and you scratching your head trying to figure out, Lord, how am I going to get out of this? God has said, come into me, I'll bring you out of it. I won't let you fall if you lean on me. Oh, I wish I had some saints in the house today.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Hallelujah. He said, but you are washed and you are sanctified, and now you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Come on, put your hands together if you would, praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But we're living in a time, praise God, where people lie to one another, and people get away with lying to you because I'm just going to be honest with you. If I know, there's probably two reasons why somebody can lie to someone on a regular basis and get away with it. The first one is that the person doesn't realize that what they're saying is a lie. The second case is where the person who's receiving the lie enjoys being lied to. Come on, come on. Now you stop and think about that for a second. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sister come to you and say, hey, I saw your husband down at the two-dime motel with Sally Mae. You don't want to believe that. You'd rather just mind your own business. Are y'all hearing me? There are so many times where someone has come to us, people have come to us with truth. And we, God knows, I have not always received truth. When I heard, there are times when I would prefer you either just don't tell me nothing at all, or tell me what I want to hear. Tell me what I want to hear, I'll feel better. But the only problem with that is that I'll feel better only until the truth is revealed. Come on, somebody. Oh, and then it's going to slap you in the face. Oh, yes, it will. Oh, yeah, it's going to slap you in the face, boy. All that time you was hiding from the truth. And when it's just like a spring. If you hit me with this much, it don't hurt as bad than if you get this much and then let it go. Hallelujah. I don't want you to tell me right when it's like right here. I don't want to hear it. Just let me go. Let me believe what and all the while it's just and that spring is stretching. That tension is getting tight. Praise God. And when that truth is revealed, guess what? It's going to hurt you more than if you'd heard it sooner.
Yes.
It's going to hurt you more than if you received it earlier.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Are y'all hearing me today?
Yes.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Don't run from the truth. Seek the
truth.
If you really want to be free, seek the truth. Seek the truth. Hallelujah. Jude chapter 1, beginning at verse number 3, if you would, please. For the sake of time, I want to go ahead and I knew. Praise God, but it's all right. I just want to speak what God tells me to speak. Praise God. Hallelujah. Go ahead. Verse number 3.
Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of a common salvation.
When I gave all diligence, I really worked hard to come up with the right words to say unto you. I studied and I prayed. Jude, it's only one chapter in the book of Jude. He said, I studied hard to make sure that I had the right words to say when I wrote unto you. I gave all diligence. I made sure that I didn't use anything that came from my own mind. I made sure that what I spoke was the will of God only. Amen. Read on.
Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of a common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you.
You got to a point to where I couldn't just let it keep going on. Hallelujah. The situation had progressed to the point to where I couldn't just sit back and just not say anything at all. So I spent time agonizing. Oh, God, what to say? Oh, God, what to preach? Oh, God, what to write? Father, your people are being destroyed for lack of knowledge. God, what do I say? What do I do? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It finally got to the point to where I had to write. He said, I didn't do this because there's no pleasure in me to say some of the things that I've got to say unto you. But I've got to say them because these things are what? Needful. These things are needful. Hallelujah, that I write unto you. Go on.
And exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for
How shall we contend?
Earnestly.
Earnestly. Earnestly. Meaning that I've got to get aggressive with this thing. Meaning that I can't do this thing passively. Meaning I can't have the attitude, oh, well, if it works, it works. If it don't work, oh, well, bless God, I was yours. No, sir. He said, earnestly contend. When you earnestly contend for something, that means you are going to fight with all you got to hold on to what you got. Amen?
Amen.
To contend means to fight.
Amen.
When there's contention, it's talking about a situation to where there are people fighting with one another. Yeah. Earnestly contend. Not to make your point.
Come on.
Earnestly contend not to prove the other one wrong, but earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. When Jesus poured out, when God poured out the Spirit, the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost, praise God, they went through a time frame of about 10, 12, 15 years, probably 20 years maybe, to where all those things you read in the book of Acts, how that, praise God, signs and wonders and miracles and things were taking place. Hallelujah. Thousands were being saved. Hallelujah. Because they had that initial faith that had been given unto them. And they were walking in it. They were talking in it. They were living it. Hallelujah. So Jude is saying, now Jude wrote this somewhere between 65 and 80 years after Christ died. Somewhere between 65 and 80 years after Christ died is when he wrote this letter to the church. Okay? So he's saying that we've gotten ourselves in such a bad situation that we're going to have to fight to claw ourselves out of this situation. We're going to have to fight hard to claw ourselves out of the hole that we have dug for ourselves. Hallelujah. I don't pray like I used to pray. But you can't just, when you realize you're not praying like you ought to pray, praise God, you need to pray, man. If you got to scream and cry, whatever you got to do in order to get yourself back in a prayer mode. Oh, y'all not hearing me today. People have lost their prayer lives and they act like, oh, well, I ain't lost nothing. Oh, yes, you have. You've lost something valuable. Hallelujah. When you lose your prayer life, you have lost something. You have lost one of the major keys to your deliverance. Men ought to always pray and not faint. Hallelujah. He said, earnestly contend. So like I said, this is not going to be in the top 10 most popular message. You know why? Because people like it easy. Don't tell me, I don't want to hear all that. Just tell me that God loves me and I'll give you a good offering and I can go home and watch the game. Hallelujah. Just tell me God loves me. Keep telling me that God loves you, God loves you, God loves you, God loves you. Oh, God loves you, God loves you. And God does love us. But he loves us enough to tell us the truth. Can I get a witness in the house today?
Amen.
Hallelujah. He loves us enough to tell us just like it is. Y'all know what I've always said, praise God, about what I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach the truth. I'm going to preach the whole truth. I'm going to preach nothing but the truth. So help me God. That's my vow. And I know that when you do this, praise God, everybody's not going to love you because they didn't love Jesus Christ. They didn't love the disciples. Hallelujah. Listen, when you preach the whole truth, you got to be willing to lose your life. Now, I'm going to say this again. When you're not afraid, Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation to every man that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And then he went on to say, for therein is the righteousness of Christ, of God revealed. The righteousness of God is revealed in this gospel. You want to know what righteousness is? The righteousness is revealed in this gospel.
So when you won't get into this word to know what the word says, that tell me you're not concerned with the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. I was doing some plumbing work, and there was a certain thing that I wanted to do. This was on yesterday, praise God. And I didn't know how to do it. I went to Lowe's. It's something I need to do over here. And so I left here, and I went to Lowe's, and I was walking up and down the aisle in the plumbing section looking for something to give me direction on how I was going to take care of this situation. Didn't find it, so I called my wife and told her. I said, I'll be home in a little bit. When I got home, y'all know what I do, right? I went to YouTube. And y'all know I went to YouTube. And I said, I got a situation here, and I need some wisdom on how to handle it. So I watched a couple of YouTube videos, and I thought, man, that looks simple. Now, when I used to do a lot of work like that, praise God, back when I had to rent houses and stuff, some of these new gadgets they have now, they didn't have those then. The name of it was called I can't even call the name now. But I got it written down in my phone. So when I go to Lowe's tomorrow, I know what to pick up, praise God. Hallelujah. So when you don't know something, don't just sit back and just say, oh, well, I don't know. You have to begin to search. You have to begin, get a mind to seek to know the truth. Everybody is not going to tell you the truth. And it's not that anybody... Not necessarily that they're intentionally trying to lie to you, but some people can only tell you what they know. And if what they know is not the truth, then guess what they're going to pass on to you? Untruth. Amen. Read on, sister. I'm sorry.
For there are certain men crept in unawares.
What? There are what?
Certain men.
Certain brothers.
Crept in.
They crept in. What you mean by crept in? They sneaked in. They walked in just like y'all walked in here. They sat out in that pew, and they dress just like you dress. They got no crazy hairstyles. Amen. I was watching Sister Banks on yesterday. Praise God. And they were talking about how they're having to go back and redo some of the things the way that they used to have ordained people into ministry. She said, we're having to go back. She said, God has spoken to me. And she began to read a prophecy that God has spoken to her and given her specific instructions and to let her know this is where you got off track. This is what you did wrong. This is what you have to correct. This is what you have to fix. And she was sitting there teaching, and she was talking how that so many people, because people have walked in and given the impression that they were men and women of God. They've given the impression that they were men and women of God, and we have just believed them. We believe their testimony. Because they live pretty good around us. And this apparently was happening with her, or has happened. And they've had to pull some people and sit them down because they set them up, praise God, believing that they were saved. And I heard them say this, and it just was so like, Lord Jesus, hallelujah. This is just confirming what you put in my spirit about these false Christs and these false prophets and the people who are sitting right among us. They crept in, ran, and sat right beside you, was waving the hand. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burden down. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And they crept in among certain men, crept in unawares. They came in so quietly you didn't even know it. They didn't come in making a lot of noise. They didn't come in, and I'm serious. And this, listen, we need to understand the devil, and we've always said this, the devil is not running around in a red suit with horns and a pitchfork. Come on, y'all. Come on, come on.
He's not going to draw that kind of attention to himself.
No.
I heard somebody make this statement the other day, how that if the serpent came up to me talking like he did Eve, I would run away. I'm not so sure that animals talking was so unusual at the time. Okay? I heard a minister making this statement that how that if that serpent had come up to me talking, I would yeah, the devil be talking to folks now and they don't run.
That's right.
Come on, y'all.
Come on.
He be talking to folks right now. He's right on your shoulder saying, give her a piece of your mind. Hallelujah. Tell her what you think about this. And you know that ain't God. Hallelujah. And you listen to that, but you wouldn't listen to the serpent. Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Glory to God. You listening? And that's the problem, is that you should not have been entertaining that kind of conversation. Hallelujah. Read on, Sister Faye. They crept in.
Unawares.
Mm-hmm.
Who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men.
What kind of men?
Ungodly men.
What kind of men?
Ungodly men.
They wore a three-piece suit. They had robes on. Ungodly men. Y'all see how common Brother Ken is? Y'all see, listen. I don't think I've had on a robe since I was in a choir. I think that's probably the last time I wore a robe, amen? Y'all know how I'm sweating up here now. Just imagine if I was up here with a robe on. I'm going to need a fan on both sides. One up here spinning down on me, praise God. Hallelujah. Ungodly men. What else, Sisters Faye?
Turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness.
They turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. They started preaching that gain is godliness. Come on, somebody. They started preaching and making people feel and believe that you're not blessed unless you're rich. Oh, the prosperity gospel. Hallelujah. You don't have what I have, so you must be doing something wrong. No, sir, no, ma'am. That's not the criteria for knowing when somebody is blessed. Are y'all hearing me today? The Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. That's when you're blessed. Hallelujah. The Bible says you're blessed when you hunger and thirst after righteousness. That's when you're blessed. The Bible says you're blessed. Praise God. When men revile you and you take it and you pray for them, that's when you're blessed. He didn't say you were blessed because you got more money than you can put in the bank. You have to have 5 different bank accounts. That don't mean you're blessed. Oh, I wish I had somebody that heard me today,
hallelujah.
Praise God. I'm going to tell the truth, praise God. And if you hear this truth, you're going to be made free. Because when you hear this truth, you're going to stop setting your affection on things of this earth.
Yes, come on.
Hallelujah. You're going to set your affection on things above. Hallelujah. Where Christ sits at the right hand of the Father. That's where my affections are, praise God. I'm sending up treasures, praise God, up into heaven, praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. They turned the grace of God into lasciviousness. And what else did they do, Sister Faye?
And denying the only Lord God.
Instead of denying themselves, they denied God.
And our Lord Jesus Christ.
Instead of Jesus said, deny yourself. If you want to be my disciple, he said, deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow me.
But instead of them denying themselves, they live a life that shows they're denying Jesus Christ. Amen. They have this form of godliness. Amen. Hallelujah. And I ain't talking about nobody today, praise God, Amen. Except those that's guilty. Oh, shoe fit. Hallelujah. He said, I will therefore put you in remembrance. I'm going to keep reminding you. I'm going to keep reminding you. Even though at one time you knew this. Is that what he says here in verse number 5? At one time you knew this. Amen. You knew this. How that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed them that believed not. You can get saved right now because you believe. But when you start walking like an unbeliever, this once save, always save doctrine did not come from God. This once save, always save doctrine did not come from God. And Jude is reminding them. He said, I'm doing this to remind you how that, and you should already know this, how that God, after he saved them out of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let me skip. Oh, man. I don't want to skip. Sister Faye, go to Galatians chapter 1, please, ma'am. Galatians chapter 1. Praise God. And the reason that I'm talking about this today is because people are running after false gods, man. They're running after false gospels. They're running after false Christs. And they call themselves trying to be free. Hallelujah. But the freedom that they're looking for is not going to strengthen them in the things of the Spirit. The freedom that they're going to find is this freedom that's going to bring death upon them eventually. False gospels satisfy what we feel is going to make us happy. Hallelujah. Praise God. Sister Faye bought that big old carton of Bluebell. Cherry what? Cherry vanilla. And after I ate it all, she going to come to me, well, you didn't save me none. I told her. Hallelujah. I told her, I said, you had a whole month. It was in that same freezer that I found it in. You could have gone in there. You had a whole month. It wasn't no month. I said, yeah, the whole month. I gave you to eat you some cherry, whatever it was. It's gone now. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, help me. Hallelujah. But we're going to always do what feels good to us, aren't we? That bluebell was feeling good. It was feeling good going down. And y'all know I've had this situation with my heart. So I don't eat a lot of stuff, not like I used to, that's heavy in cholesterol and stuff. So I really governed myself. I was really temperate. I really used moderation. Just got instead of those pint-sized scoops I used to get, I just get a spoon, two or three spoonfuls, and sit down and just kind of eat it. You know, that carton of ice cream, probably I had at least 10, 12 sit-downs. Amen. And I thought I was doing pretty good. I thought I was doing pretty good. You ate up all the ice cream and didn't save me no. Boy, I love Sister Faye. Ain't she pretty, y'all? Listen, man. Listen. The Bible says this. The Bible says that if a man find a good wife, a man find a wife, he's found a good thing. Amen. And I have to say, God has blessed me with one virtuous woman. Hallelujah. I'm serious. He has blessed me with one virtuous woman. Praise God.
And listen, I'm a grateful old man. Hallelujah. Praise God. But I wanted to talk about these false gospels today because there are so many folks being swept away. And they're being swept away because they have no foundation. Jesus began to speak this. Jesus said, if you're going to build a house, don't build it on the sand. He said, if you're going to build a house, build it on a solid foundation. Are y'all hearing me today? He said, don't build it on something that when the winds come and the floods beat up on it, that it's going to be just carried away and swept away. Don't build your house like that. And too many folks are looking for, and it's okay. It's the house that's built like that is okay until the trials come. Come on, somebody. You can have a defective house. You can have a defective car. You can have a defective heart. And you may never know it until you put that rascal to the test. You give it a stress test. Praise God, you out there running just like you did 30 years ago. And you know, and before you know it, you're like, because you done put something on it that it's not accustomed to. So you can build your house on defective gospel, and you'll be okay until you go through the storm. You're gonna look like, boy, God is really blessing me. Ooh, we're living. Ooh, this is the life. You go through the storm, and then you ain't got no power. You ain't got no prayer life. You go through the storm, and you can't. And it's like, Lord, I ain't prayed in so long, I forgot how to pray. Hallelujah, Jesus. Go ahead, Sister Fain. Galatians chapter 1, verse number 6.
I marvel that you are so soon removed.
So soon. So soon removed. Go ahead.
From him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel.
Unto a what?
Another gospel.
Unto a what?
Another gospel.
I thought all churches was the same. Do you not know that the majority of Christian people believe that every church is the same? That they're all teaching the same gospel. Hallelujah. Paul said, I marvel that you are so soon removed. Paul wrote this letter about 45 AD. 45 years after Christ died. They came to the, and this letter which was given to the Gentiles. I want you to follow me on the chronology of time, okay? Paul, I don't know how many years it was, maybe a couple of years after Christ that Paul got saved. After Paul got saved, there was at least 14 years that after he got saved, that he went away just to spend time learning God. Just to spend time getting to know God. And after he went away, he said, it was pleased God who revealed his son in me. He said, I received all these things by revelation from God. I was not one of the original 12 apostles. But God spoke to me person to person and gave me my mission orders. So at least 16, 18 years passed. He comes back and he meets with Peter and the other apostles. And they begin to talk. And then Paul began to share with them the things that God has shown unto him. And as he began to testify unto them, they knew for certainty that this man has truly been with the Lord. His testimony, he's truly been with God. Hallelujah. So we are 20, 25 years now. So Paul goes out. He and Barnabas, and they go out and they're teaching the Gentiles. This was after Peter had gone to Cornelius to talk with him. You'll read about it in Acts chapter 10 and Acts chapter 11. Paul had gone out to and was preaching to the Gentiles. And he and just doing a quick chronology of time, that church couldn't have been more than about 15, 20 years old. And he said, I marvel that you are so quickly removed from the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ unto another gospel. Hallelujah. Jews said they allowed them creepers to come in. They brought damnable heresies. And they didn't do it overnight. A little leaven. A little leaven. Hallelujah. Read on, Sister Faye. Begin reading at verse number 6 again, if you would.
I marvel that you are so soon removed.
I'm surprised.
From him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel.
Oh, Jesus.
Which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ.
There really isn't another gospel. There are teachings that people call the gospel, but there is only one gospel of Jesus Christ. Are y'all hearing me today? And the gospel of Jesus Christ is all truth and no lie. Amen. Are you hearing me now? Amen. If I preach anything that's not the truth, it's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. If I teach you anything that's not, that's why I asked you guys the question a few weeks ago. And the question stays on my mind. If I show you the truth, will you believe it? If I show you the truth, will you believe it? Because what I'm going to do by showing you the truth is the truth is going to uncover. The truth is going to uncover a few things. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Jesus. Let me cover this and then I'm going to let you guys go. We're going to pray. Here are a couple of lies that Satan gives the people as a reason for not obeying the truth. One of the lies he tells them is that, and people believe this, I don't need the Holy Ghost to get to heaven. My confession that I believe in God is all that's required. Wrong. Wrong, wrong, wrong. The Bible says if any man, not Brother Ken, the Bible says, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. That's not Brother Ken. Jesus said it. I didn't say it. Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man is born of the water and of the Spirit, he's not going to enter into the kingdom of God. Amen. That's not the gospel of Brother Ken. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise God. Something else they say. I don't need a pastor in this new church era. I can find the will of God on my own. I can do what I want. I can do it when I want to. And I can do it how I want to without having anybody's supervision. People who have that mindset, praise God, have their mindset is such that they don't want to be accountable to God's authority. I'm just being honest with you. They don't want to be accountable to God's authority when you find people who have that mindset. Praise God. Look at what the word says. The word says this in Jeremiah. He said, I will give you, Jeremiah 3 and 15. He said, I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. That's not taking away from your intelligence. It's not taking away from your holiness because you have a teacher. Praise God. That's not taking away from your ability to comprehend because you submit to God's authority. But when you find an individual who will not submit to God's authority, that's a person that God is not happy with. Oh, Jesus. He said, Obey them. Why? Because they're watching for your souls. And he told the shepherds, he told the pastors, he said, feed the sheep that is among you. He said, take the oversight. He said, not as being a lord over God's heritage, but as being an example. Show them what it means to be humble. Show them what it means to have a prayer life. Show them what it means to walk in integrity. Show them what it means to love God with the whole heart. Show them what it means. Don't lord over them like you own them, because you don't own them. Jesus, Jesus, help us today, Lord. Hallelujah. Sister Faye, read Romans chapter 10, verses 13 and 14 for me, please. Since we got some people that said, right, that's Old Testament scriptures. We don't live by them no more. We're the Old Testament. I ain't under that. Okay, thank you, thank you, thank you.
What verse is
Romans that? Chapter 10, verses 13 and 14. Okay. Hallelujah. My Bible tells me, here a little, there a little. Huh? A little bit here, a little bit there, praise God. Hallelujah. This is how we have to take this word of God. Listen, God's Old Testament scriptures are not going to contradict with what he says under the new covenant. The new covenant has been fulfilled in us. I mean, the old covenant is being fulfilled in us as we obey his word. Are y'all hearing me? Praise God. Amen. Verses number 13 and 14.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Who?
Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Who's going to be saved?
Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
All right. Do I have anybody calling on the Lord today? I'm calling on you, Jesus. I'm calling on you right now, Lord. I'm calling on you right now, Lord. I'm calling on you right now, Jesus. Hallelujah. Read on.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
What?
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
I didn't write this. I did not write this, but you know what? I'm going to submit to it. Amen. Hallelujah. I didn't write it, but I'm going to obey it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He said, how are they going to believe upon him of whom they've not heard? And how are they going to hear except God has sent somebody with the message of salvation? Hallelujah. How shall they preach except they be sent? How are they going to do it? Listen, there's an order, saints of God. There is an order in God. And we're not going to be blessed by God if we step outside of his order. Are y'all hearing me? We're not going to be blessed by God if we step outside of his order. I don't know about you guys, but I want to be blessed today. I am blessed. I am blessed, praise God. And you know what? I want to stay blessed. Hallelujah. I want to stay blessed. Hallelujah. What I do really doesn't matter. This is what the devil tells people. What I do really doesn't matter. God doesn't care about my works because I'm saved by grace. What I do doesn't matter. God ain't judging me by my works, because I'm saved by grace. And the problem with that mindset for most people is that people who say these things don't understand the grace of God. They don't understand the grace of God. They think the grace of God is permission to do wrong without any kind of punishment. That's not what the grace of God is. And you read in the book of Titus says that, Paul writes to Titus and he says, for the grace of God that brings salvation, it has appeared unto all men, teaching them that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, how that we should live soberly, godly, and righteously in this present world, And when you really begin to look into the original definitions, translations in the, from the Greek concerning this word grace, it's actually speaking about God's influence. Hallelujah. God's influence in the heart of a man. If you had, I asked you guys one time before, a couple of times before, if you don't own a concordance, if you don't know how to use one, you need to get a concordance, and you need to start using it in your studies, because there are going to be some things that are going to give you a deeper understanding than what you're going to get just by some, even by getting a deeper understanding than some of these modern translations in the Bible. Some of these modern translations in the Bible are incorrect. Some of these modern translations of the Bible have omitted scripture passages that were in the original manuscript. Praise God. But the grace of God, when you really dig down and dig into to knowing what it really is, it's God's influence on a man's heart. And it's reflected by how that man lives. When you see someone that's walking holy, you know that's the grace of God being manifested. Come on, somebody. When you see somebody walking upright, you know that's the grace, that's God's influence on their hearts. Oh, I wish I had somebody in the house that understood what I'm talking about today.
Hallelujah.
Amen. When I used to cut up and being bad, praise God, my mama used to say, you're just like your daddy. She was talking about that was my daddy's influence. But when you see me living right, that's the grace of God. Hallelujah. Oh, I wish I had some saints in the house today, praise God. You like it when I was talking about them other folks. Now I'm talking about you, praise God. You don't take it so well, huh? How you like me now? Oh, Lordy.
Preach. Yes, preach.
Jesus said this. He said, for the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels. And then he shall reward every man according to what? His works. Amen. The Son of Man, he's going to come in the glory of his Father. He says, and I've got my rewards in my hand, and I'm going to be rewarding every man according to his works. Amen. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse number 10 says this. He says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. My last scripture, I'm going to let you guys go. Sister Faye, read this for me, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, please, and we're going to pray. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 13 and 14. I'm giving you guys these because I love you. Jesus said, if you continue in my word, he said, then are you my disciples indeed, and you're going to know the truth. He said, and the truth is going to make you free. I want true freedom today. I'm tired of the lies, tired of being deceived, tired of following false ways. Praise God. You got it, Sister Faye? Mm-hmm. Go ahead, please.
Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter.
This is the end of my message.
Fear God.
Okay, this is the conclusion of my message. Y'all, please hear the conclusion of my message. And everything that I've said for the past hour and a half, this is the conclusion. What is it, Sister Faye?
Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man.
The whole duty of man. You were created for this. Hallelujah. We were created for God to be glorified in the earth. Fear God and keep his commandments, he said, for this is the whole duty of man. You know?
For God shall bring every work into judgment.
He's going to bring every work into judgment. Things that we overlook and things that we thought were unimportant. Things that we thought that really didn't matter. Didn't matter that I talked to you out of disrespect. And I never went back to apologize. I prayed about it and I asked God to forgive me, but I didn't do it right. I still should have gone back to you and asked you and begged your pardon. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what position you have, man. We've all got to humble ourselves and do the right thing. Because God's going to bring every work into judgment. Hallelujah. Read on, Sister Faye.
With every secret thing.
Everything you thought nobody saw. With every secret thing. And what else?
Whether it be good or whether it be evil.
So this, it don't matter how I live. I'm saved by grace and not by works. And we just shoot holes all through that doctrine.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And there's several other little lies here that have been given to the people to keep them in darkness and to keep them away from the truth. Why? Because the devil goes forth as a roaring lion and he doesn't want God's people to be free.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Come on, give God a hand. Praise somebody. Hallelujah. Who wants to be free today? Who wants to be free today? Praise God. If you want to be free, just stand up on your feet. We're going to pray. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Give myself away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give yourself to Him. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Hallelujah, Father, we thank you right now. We submit ourselves to you, Lord. Father, we come to you right now. Cleanse us right now, God. Cleanse us right now, Father. Purge us. Wash us right now, God. If there be any uncleanness in us, God, to be anything, Father God, that you're not pleased with. I know you've sanctified us. I know you've saved us. But Father God, there still might be something in our hearts and our minds. Hallelujah, Lord God, where we need perfecting right now. Perfect us, oh Lord God. Hallelujah, complete your work in us, God. Have your way, Lord Jesus. Have your way, Lord God, in this house. Send your spirit, Lord God. Pour out the anointing in this house today, Lord God. Save us, Lord. Saturate this place. Cleanse us, God. Forgive every sin. Forgive every sin, Lord. Forgive every sin, Lord. Wash us right now. Hallelujah. Wash us right now, Jesus. I love you. I praise you, Lord. I open my heart to you, Lord. I give myself to you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Teach me, Lord God, your ways. Give us to understand, Father God, your heart. Give us to understand, Father God, what it means to be saved. Give us to understand, Father God, how to prepare ourselves for the return. Give us to know, Father God, how that we're living in perilous times, Father God, and how important it is for us to know this word, how important it is for us to walk in truth, Father God, in righteousness and true holiness. I bind every spirit that would come to deceive. I bind every spirit that would come to trick and to lie to your people. Help us, Father God, that we not be among those, Father God, who did, even as those in Sodom and Gomorrah, even as those, Father God, who lived in Jeremiah's time, Father God, who was so corrupt in their own ways, Father God, that it demanded that you judge them. Help us today, Lord God, hallelujah, to walk upright, circumspect before you, Lord Jesus. We can't make it without you. We can't make it without you, Lord. We give ourselves to you, Lord. We give ourselves to you. We yield all of our members to you, Lord. Use us today. Use us today. Hallelujah. I want my life to be a testimony. Hallelujah, of your love, of your power, of your grace. Oh, God, I love you. I praise you. Hallelujah. There's nobody but you, Lord Jesus. I love nobody but you, Lord. Heal every infirmity in the midst of us, God. Every sickness, every disease, today I pray that
your spirit would move and to minister, to send healing and strength in their bodies, in their souls, and in their spirits.